Hello everybody, thank you for joining us today for this ADCET webinar, Assistive Technologies, Everything Access and Teaching Staff Should Know. My name is Gabrielle O'Brien and my pronouns are she and her. I am the Senior Content Development and Project Officer for ADCET, which stands for the Australian Disability Clearinghouse on Education and Training. This webinar is being live captioned by Donna from Bradley Reporting. To activate the captions, please click the CC button in the toolbar that is located either on the top or the bottom of your screen. We also have captions available via your browser, and Jane will add that to the chat box now. I'm joining you today from the lands of the Turrbal and Yagara people in Meanjin or Brisbane, Queensland, and I pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. And I extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples here today and acknowledge their ongoing connection to country, land and sea. Feel free to put what country you are on in the chat and share where you are. This webinar is being recorded. The recording will be available on the ADCET website in the coming days. Just a reminder that this webinar is 90 minutes today, so we have more time from our wonderful panel and more time for questions. Throughout the presentation, feel free to use the chat box with us and each other, but please remember to choose everyone so that we can all read what you have to say. If you have a question for the panel that you would like our presenters to answer for you, please put that in the Q&A box. If you have any technical difficulties, please email admin@adcet.edu.au. So I'm very pleased today that we're kicking off our first webinar for 2023 with the wonderful Darren Britton, one of our lovely colleagues from ADCET. Darren is ADCET's National Assistive Technology Project Officer, and he's my go-to for all things AT. He has been involved in inclusive practice and accessible resource development with the tertiary sector for over 20 years and is highly knowledgeable. So Darren, I'm going to hand over to you to introduce your panelists for today.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Gabby. And thank you, Jane. Please note, as Gabby was saying, we've got a longer session today of 90 minutes. We do have a lot to cover today, so we'll try and get through that as quick as possible. I might just first start by saying we've lied to you, saying it's everything access and teaching staff should know, because there's no way we could fit everything you need to know into this session. But we have condensed down the key aspects of the topic around assistive technologies. First up, I'd also just like to pay acknowledgement and to the traditional custodians of the country throughout Australia and their connections to land, sea and community. We pay respect to their elders past, present and emerging. And while we're virtually connected today, we are presenting geographically dispersed and acknowledge the lands from which our panellists are joining us today. And those are the lands of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation in Victoria, the Cammeraygal and the Wiradjuri people in New South Wales. So, assistive technology and AT in the tertiary environment is really what we're looking at today. What is assistive technology in its broadest sense? Who uses it and how does assistive technology support students and staff in accessing and participating in their educational goals? The panelists that we've got today will seek to, you know, unpack this and some of the other questions and hopefully dispel some myths around assistive technology and how it's currently being used by students and staff. Our panelists are from the Assistive Tech Community of Practice and Francois Jacobs, who's joined us with lived experience as well at the last minute. So thank you very much for that, Francois. He's jumped in. One of the panelists was unfortunately unable to make it today. And they're going to share their unique insights and experiences with us, and hopefully we'll answer some of your questions in the process. So as Gabby said, I'm Darren Britton. I'm the National Assistive Technology Officer for the part of the NDCO program, the National Disability Coordination Officers program, but aligned with ADCET, etc. So I won't go too much into things. I'll start and introduce the panelists. So we have joining us today, Sandra Boyd. Sandra, do you want to just give us a little bit of a who you are, what your role is, and why assistive tech matters to you.
Thanks, Darren. I'm Sandy. I'm Assistive Technology Officer at Charles Sturt University and been here since 2008. We're going for a name change next week. I previously worked at TAFE New South Wales. I've been a teacher. I've been a teacher consultant for students with vision impairments, and I looked after a lot of the assistive technologies in that time. I've run workshops in assistive technology for staff and designed programs for students with assistive technology. So over my 30 years, I've mainly worked with assistive technology to support vision impairment, but since working at Charles Sturt, I've also worked with a lot of various assistive technologies. I've got an IT background, so I was fascinated with assistive technology in my early years of teaching at TAFE. I also have a close friend who's got a vision impairment, and she uses screen readers and lots of devices. My interest in all things assistive technology and being a teacher has led me to wanting to help students to be independent learners. I'm passionate about accessibility of content material, and particularly in UDL, and I've worked across several projects with academics in online development. And I'm always looking for the next best technology to assist students. Thanks, Darren.
Excellent. Thank you, Sandy. Stephen Zelko.
Hi, my name's Steve. I am the Coordinator, Inclusive Resource Development, Tech and Training over at La Trobe University in Bundoora. My role is varied. It goes from helping students one-on-one, helping academics one-on-one, helping whole departments to sort of order their material and the way they produce content, to now working with the institution at a higher sort of level on procurement and policy. I've been working in the space since about 2005, when on my first day, when I started working for the university, I realized that I was dyslexic after finishing a degree, and have ever since sort of like been in the space, trying to understand the best ways to sort of combat approaches to students gaining sort of normality in their experience.
Thank you, Steve. Francois Jacobs.
Hi, thanks, Darren. Yes, I'm a sessional academic teaching in the disability and inclusion pathway at Deakin University. And I did 2 years ago, I also did a graduate certificate in disability inclusion there, which gave me a student perspective as well. I do some freelancing. I'm doing access, consulting on access to the arts and digital accessibility. I am blind and I use a screen reader program as well as a braille display to navigate the web. And just on the question of where would I have been without assistive technology, I literally use it for almost everything in my life. I use it to shop online. I use it to buy my tickets to sports and arts events. I use it to socialize, and I use it to study and to teach. So really essential for me that assistive technology works.
Excellent. Thank you, Francois. And Andrew Downey.
Hello, Andrew Downey. I was born with a condition called congenital glaucoma, which meant that I had very little vision until the age of 15, and after that, no vision. And I left a year after, I left school after year 10 because everyone decided that was the pinnacle of my academic ability. But subsequently, I finished up with an honours degree in psychology, which is my major interest in life, and a postgrad diploma in education. And although I was registered as a psychologist, somehow my career sort of took me down this path of technology, and I partly because I have an aptitude for it, and like Francois, find it really, really valuable for myself. But I worked for 25 years for TAFE in the area of assistive technology across all types of disabilities. And I retired from that job 4 years ago. I now work one day a week for UTS as an accessibility consultant, and my role is specifically to work with students in the area of, you've guessed it, assistive technology. That's all, I think. Thanks, Darren.
Excellent. Thank you, Andrew. I may just add in as well, for myself, why assistive technology matters, and probably true of, it's estimated somewhere around 60% of the world's population wears corrective lenses on their face. I'm wearing my assistive tech right here. Without it, I kind of can't function, can't drive, can't use a computer, can't do that. So assistive tech comes in many ways, shapes and forms. So I'll, given that being the topic, I'll throw to you, Andrew, if you can give us a breakdown of the forms of assistive tech, and what is assistive technology?
Okay. Types of assistive technology. My definition is equipment which is purpose-built or modified existing equipment to meet the needs of people who have disabilities. For the purpose of this webinar, we'll be focusing on equipment which supports staff and students in an educational setting. Forms of assistive technology. Physical devices. Installed local software, online software or software as a service, apps on mobile devices and desktop computers, browser extensions. I've broken the equipment I'm going to talk about into categories according to disability types, and that's sort of useful, but as you'll see as I go through, a lot of the technologies overlap between the various types of disability. So we need to be flexible as we think about the various tools. But let's look at vision impairment first. That's probably the easiest one to categorise. Text, graphics, enlargement, both hardware and software. So hardware includes everything from Darren's spectacles up to handheld magnifiers and electronic magnifiers, and they have become very sophisticated, the electronic ones, both portable and things that sit on a desk. Some of them include optical character recognition and speech output as well. Screen readers. What is a screen reader? Screen reader is software that presents information that is normally presented on the screen to the user via either synthetic speech and or electronic braille display. Talking about synthetic speech, until relatively recently, 20 years or so, to get synthetic speech onto a computer, you had to buy, and I mean buy, a box which plugged into the computer via a cable. These days, all the platforms include synthetic speech, and there are still commercial products available if you want them as well. Electronic braille display. Little pins that pop up and down in the shape of braille cells can be anything from 14 cells up to 80 cells, and even more these days. And they can connect to your phone or your computer via either Bluetooth or a cable. Audio descriptions. Valuable for, say, a movie or an instructional video to tell someone who can't see what's happening that is visual in nature. Hard copy braille, and one of my favorites, tactile diagrams. Let's move on to hearing loss and deafness. Hearing aids. They have become much more sophisticated over the past several decades. You can now tune them to, certainly to the type of hearing loss, but also to the particular environment that you're working with. Hearing loops. A hearing loop is essentially a coil of copper wire, can be in anything as small as a phone and as large as an auditorium. And a person with a hearing aid flicks the switch and they can pick up what's coming from the PA system. Captions and sign language as a service, so captions, most of you will be familiar with. There is a difference between captions and subtitles, in that captions should include auditory information, whereas subtitles don't do that. Visual sounds. If I make a mistake on the computer, I get an ugly sound to tell me I've made a mistake. If you can't hear the sound, you can turn on a visual sound. So instead of getting this ugly sound, you get blinded by a flash of light in your eyes. Physical disabilities. Alternative keyboards. They can be bigger, smaller, one-handed keyboards, huge diversity, programmable keyboards, again, to meet the needs of people with a whole range of different needs. On-screen keyboards, as the name suggests, the keyboard appears on the screen, and they can be used by the following technologies. A mouse or a mouse emulation device. A mouse emulation device could include a joystick, a head-mounted pointing device which connects to the computer via a sensor, or the wonderful eye gaze technology. Switches are used by people who have very limited physical movement. They would test my impetuosity to no end, but can be a valuable resource for people with very limited movement. Speech input has become more and more accessible as the decades have gone on. Neurological disability. Reading and writing assistance, literacy assistance, the products such as Read and Write, Claro Read, the immersive tools in Microsoft Office all come to mind. Ability to adjust the text size and colour and the spacing to meet needs, augmented with synthetic speech, grammar assistance, etc. Word prediction software, again, that probably can be used by everyone or most people, and can, particularly helpful if you have to write very slowly. Electronic dictionaries. As someone who, as a kid, didn't have ready access to a dictionary at all, of course, Braille dictionaries are awfully bulky. It is great for me to have ready access to a dictionary on the computer. And for people who are poor spellers, or having access to an electronic dictionary in all sorts of forms is really most valuable. Note-taking assistance software. So for people who have trouble keeping up with lectures, handwriting, or using a keyboard, products such as Glean come to mind, where you can record the lecture and annotate as you go through, and then go home and embellish your notes later on. Well, that's all for me, I think. Thanks, Darren.
Thank you very much, Andrew. As you can see, it's certainly not an extensive list, and we could do a whole hour and a half just on any one of those bullet points, you know, from any one of those slides there, and we still wouldn't be able to cover everything that's there. So what we're aiming to do today, as I mentioned earlier, is to go through some of the key kind of questions that we all have commonly, you know, been asked, and try and set a bit of the stage for where are we kind of at with assistive tech, as we're saying, who uses it and how that's there. So I'm going to throw some questions out now to the panel. Our first question, I'll throw this to you first, Sandy, which is, what are the best questions to ask new students that may need new or additional assistive technology?
Yeah, so what what I do is I'm you most of the time not the first person in Charleston to interview the student. It's usually the disability liaison officer, and then they determine maybe they might be able to benefit from using an assistive technology, and then it gets referred to assistive technology officer, and there's two at Charles Sturt. My first question I usually ask students is, what's their greatest impact at the moment? So, like, I've read all their documentation, what they've said to the disability liaison officer. So if they've got multiple conditions, you know, what's their greatest impact? Because we might just work with one of those things to start with. I've also would ask, have they used assistive technology before? You know, they might have studied before. How long ago? Like, if it was 20, 30 years ago, things have changed so much, which we'll talk about towards the end, the future. And what have they used before? How did it benefit them from before? Maybe they were given something at a different institute and they said, oh, I didn't really like it, didn't get training, didn't use it. So we thought, all right, let's try something different. If they're hearing impaired, what is their preferred communication? Not everybody's an Auslan, knows Auslan. They'd have to be, I would say, pretty proficient in Auslan if they want Auslan interpretation. They might prefer, not all students like audio transcription as a separate document, because then they've got to look at maybe the lecture, the slide, and the transcription. They might prefer live captioning. So I always ask a student with a hearing impairment, if we're going to go down that path to a system in transcription, what's their preferred format, communication format? If they've got a significant vision impairment, do they read Braille? Are they a Braille native? And if it is Braille, like if they learnt Braille when they are a child, they're then coming to, you know, tertiary, TAFE or universities, they may not be used to using screen readers all the time. And, you know, to prepare a textbook in, I know at TAFE days, prepare a textbook in Braille, we'd be talking, you know, boxes and boxes, like Andrew talked about before, boxes of Braille books. That might not be the best solution at a tertiary level course. And so do they need to learn a screen reader? Have they ever used a screen reader then? And then if they haven't, I'd be sending them, telling them, look, how about you go and learn how to use, get an OT assessment. If they've had an OT, so get some training from Vision Australia or Blind Citizens or someone like that, because then they're learning that and they're learning their study as well, plus your normal work life commitments. That's an awful lot and a lot of pressure as well. I'd also, Andrew touched, depending on the type of course, if they are significant with a vision impairment, will they need tactile diagrams? Have they ever used tactile diagrams before? And they take a lot of preparation within a course as well. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you, Sandy.
Steve?
Steve?
Very similar vein, but usually what I start with is what's your pie in the sky sort of piece of tech, or what's your pie in the sky sort of adjustment, or like what's the best case scenario, because that usually gives me an indication of what they want from the things that we're offering. So we try to start off with a positive and see, okay, what is it you would like to be able to do, and then we work sort of backwards from there. But it's also stuff like what platform are you using, that usually gives you an indication of how literate they are with the tech. So if they don't know the platform, then you're probably going to have to start with something very simple. If they know exactly the thing that they're using, they're probably very proficient with it, and that's a smaller percentage of students. It's about sort of gauging what their history is, what they want, and what we can sort of offer in that space. Very similar sort of vein, but a few different approaches.
Thank you, Steve. Andrew, I'm sure you've got some views on this.
Yeah, I think the other two have covered it pretty well, but just very briefly, my first introduction to the student would be asking them really what problems they're having, how does their disability affect their ability to study, what areas do they need help with, and that can give us both a clue as to what sort of things we might be looking at that might be helpful. But keeping in mind all the things that the others have said about, finding out, you know, what they've used before, what their interests are, and so forth. It's worth keeping in mind that it can be one of these situations where you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make a drink. Not all students are enthusiastic about using products that aren't sort of what their colleagues are using and so forth. So sometimes some perseverance can pay off. Other times it's the student wants to do it their way. Thanks, Darren.
Yes, thank you, Andrew. We've just compared students to horses for those that are keeping count, and we can go from there. Which leads me perfectly into, and Steve, I might throw to you first with this one. Us students, digital natives, we hear this quite often. So are students digital natives when it comes to assistive technology?
I'm not sure where this myth started, but it couldn't be further from the truth. You get the spectrum, but the quote-unquote digital natives are maybe 10 to 15%. They know their phones very well. They don't know much about the settings in their phones very well. They know even less about the settings in a computer very well. It's kind of one of those misnomers. You get the whole spectrum. I just spoke to a student yesterday who was still using a printer to print off things as his preference. That was his assistive tech preference. Because he didn't like any of the stuff. It's an interesting myth, but from my experience, they're as much digital natives as anyone else. It's a matter of interest than rather just expectation on that cohort. Yeah.
Yep. Sandy?
I'd also add that you can't assume because of the age of the student, they know they're digital natives. So, I've spoken some students have come out of secondary and starting undergraduate courses. They may not have received any assistive technology support while at high school, and not just assistive tech, but even just they don't seem to have the same computer skills. Yeah, maybe they know their phone. So you can't assume by age, and then you might have someone who's 60, 70 year old using a computer all the time and they're quite au fait with it. I'd also ask, how many devices? So, phones are pretty common, but what about the computer and tablets and things like that?
And I think that's an important point. Students are coming with multitudes of devices now, or they'll have access to a multitude. They may not have themselves or their learning equipment. And then we present them with a whole bunch of different equipment at their institutions as well that may be slightly foreign to them, that has different software on, et cetera. So, sometimes these things are portable, sometimes they're not. And they're using different devices in different environments, for different learning purposes. What may be good for one subject might be having it played back, and another environment may be, no, I need to actually see it on screen and I need to be doing this with it, et cetera. I need to be able to navigate it. So that's a really good point. But I do hear that a lot, that students are digital natives, and we'll just recommend this bit of software and let them go off into the wild, which, Andrew, I'll throw this one to you. So what is the best way to introduce new assistive technology to a student?
The term best way worries me, again, because our students are so diverse, there may not be one best way. If a student already has quite reasonable, for example, computer skills, but they need to learn a new piece of software, then it may be that a lot of students will be able to work that out with a little bit of input as to what they can be expecting from it. If it's something entirely different, so say speech input, will often take a lot more work, or learning to use a screen reader. Ideally, they get the training from someone who knows how to use it well. I have this, I suspect, slightly chauvinistic notion that people who are shown how to use a screen reader by another blind person usually pick it up quicker than being shown by a sighted person, because the concepts are somewhat well. You need to be very structured to use a screen reader on a computer effectively, and people who are used to using a mouse often don't think in that fashion. So yes. Formal training, if necessary, from someone who knows how to use it well and how to teach it well. I think that would be my synopsis.
Thank you. Steve?
Adding to that, definitely someone that is, it's knowledge by acquaintance rather than knowledge by description. But we try to use sort of a multi-varied approach to introducing anything to a student and have it the lowest barrier of entry as possible, because you often find that the majority of students who want to try something out, they want something that's going to be easy for them to get into and easy for them to sort of play around with and all this sort of stuff. So, for us, it's definitely the lowest barrier for entry possible. Whether the thing is free is always a good thing, and how much they can get done without too much of an overhead, because they're just not going to, in a practical sort of manner, they're not going to devote time to something that's not facilitating good outcomes for them. And not just quickly, but it's got to be, the juice has got to be worth the squeeze in some respect. In that way, we try to minimize the cognitive overhead for it. But the ways that we support that, we have the sessions, we have the one-on-one sessions, we have the training sessions, we have a whole bunch of documentation. We have a Teams channel that has a whole bunch of tech options in it that they can just look at their own sort of leisure. They have guides to all that sort of stuff as well. So we put it in as leading the horse to water, back to that. But we do give them multiple sources of water and say, choose which one sort of supports you and the way that your sort of learning style. Because what we found is that some students want the one-on-one, the really intensive sort of, this is how you use it, this is how it's done. They want that directed learning. And some other students, they want to be shown the idea, and then they want to go and investigate the idea for themselves. And you've got to have that resource, that secondary resource or that alternative resource to support that type of learning as well. So they can go back and feel like, oh, I can play with it in my own time and I can kind of buy into it a little bit.
Good point. Sandy?
Yeah, I'd add also, if they've been recommended, say, more than one type of assistive technology, so I'm thinking even software, it could be a text-to-speech program, so plus, say, a note-taking like Glean or something, and their technology is not great, their skills, is just introduce it in a gradual transitioning, or how about you just start with text-to-speech, this session, and maybe we'll start introducing all the note-taking, whatever. I think some software, speech to text, it does take quite a while. But I'm also thinking like something like read and write for learning disabilities. There's so many functions in the read and write that they may not need all of them. And when you open read and write, it's got a toolbar with all the functions open. Let's just start with a couple of functions. Let's work out which functions will be the best to start with, and let's turn all the other icons off. And then gradually the student, with their interest, they can then open up some of those other functions.
That's a really good point. And speaking of that, I'll throw to Francois for our next question. And that's, how long does it take students to adopt a new technology?
That's like asking how long is a piece of string, because everybody is different. You get some people who are really good on their iPhone, but they absolutely struggle with Windows. So for me, the thing is to really encourage people to frequently engage with the access technology, whatever it is that they learned from as soon as they had this training from. Because really, if you don't embed the skills when you learn it, you lose it really, really quickly. And then all that training is kind of down the drain. So some people would learn a screen reader, maybe just to answer you more specifically, within months. And others may never be really good at it. And that's why I can relate to what other people have said. Have more than one tool in your toolbox. All you really want is to be able to keep up with your studies and pass and hopefully get better at some, but you don't have to push through with one type of access technology if maybe your aptitude for another one is just naturally better.
And I think that's a good point. There are so many tools that are out there now, you know, having you know, learning some of the basic functions in a range of them will give you that opportunity to interact differently with different things in different cases. And that's right. Students want to get through their subject and do that. They don't want to, unless they're doing their degree on the program or a particular bit of software, it's best that we, you know, give them the space to explore with that. Sandy.
Yeah, I think it also depends. Are they doing undergraduate or postgraduate? Maybe they have already done undergraduate at another institution and they'd already been using the technology there. So, you know, they're just coming along, come to a new university, doing postgraduate, PhDs, whatever. They just need, off they go. They don't need any help at all. Maybe they didn't have their disability condition when they're an undergraduate and it's something that's developed now they're doing postgraduate. So it depends on their timing around their work. It's also, you know, how long is it going to take? Well, you're fitting in. I always look at what commitments has the student already got? You know, are they working full-time, part-time? They're studying, how many subjects are they doing? Family commitments and all that. And just thinking about all those other commitments is how long are they going to take? And I think, like Steve said, some students just never, oh no, Francois said it, didn't you? Some students just don't get it, and I'll probably still be training with the same student 12 months later in exactly the same program and going over the same training, and that's okay. So it's just they just need a little bit more support.
Yep, thank you. So what is the best way for students to get training in assistive technology? So Steve.
I mean, you hear this quite a few times, but it depends on the student. Again, we sort of come at it a few different ways because we know that you're probably going to hit more retention with multiple sort of points of access. So it's definitely the one-on-one stuff with someone, as Andrew said, with someone that really knows it. And that's kind of where the convergence comes with sort of having advisors that are not just aware of some of the stuff, but also actively use it, which is another sort of, you know, another buy-in. If the person who's introducing them to it is a user of it, the retention just goes up exponentially. So there's definitely ways that you can approach introducing them to the tech and the training that you get benefit of without it being direct. We also have peer learning advisors at La Trobe, and we've kind of indoctrinated them, for you know, lack of another term, but brought them into the process. And if that produces another point of access for them, so they see someone that is currently learning, might not have their disability or their needs or anything like that, but they're also using a tech in a way that can support the student in the way that they want to learn as well. And there are students in those peer learning advisor groups that do have disabilities and do use the tech. So it's that multiple point of access to initiate the training. As the need is more complex, or the requirement is more complex, might be a better way to say it, then you start getting into the specialist stuff, and that requires much more training. So you get much more complex sort of training sessions and going through everything from tactile images to, you know, we're using BCI at the moment, the brain sort of character recognition stuff, and that requires a lot of work, but you know, some of the outcomes are pretty good.
Thank you, Steve. Andrew.
sorry, the question was,
sorry, having trained many students in time, what's the best way for students to get training in assistive technology?
Yeah, I thought we'd covered that one. just to reiterate what I said before, trained by someone who knows the product and has an intuition for how it works. I think that's going to be my go-to. if the student is keen to read documentation, by all means do that. I'm a fan of reading documentation. I've always had the notion that the person who produced the product must know something about it. Now, some documentation is better than others. In fact, some of it's awful and some of it's very, very good. I've worked with people who are almost proud of the fact that they won't read a manual, and I find that very frustrating because it can run them into limitations fairly quickly. Along with formal training by people who know the product, encourage reading documentation and talking to other users. That can be really quite valuable. For some of these technologies, there are user groups and there are lists, email lists that people can subscribe to, or Facebooks and such for those who use that. And that can be really quite valuable because sometimes the person might run into a particular problem, can't find the answer quickly, drop it into a forum and someone will pop back very quickly with, oh, just do this, and it's all fixed. So that's another useful resource as well. And a lot of this stuff takes perseverance. And Sandy's already mentioned, people's commitment. And I suspect that most students with significant disabilities are going to have to spend more time and effort on their study than other students to get similar results. And it might be discriminatory, but it's the way the world is. And for those of us who enjoy this stuff most of the time, experimenting with the product and finding out what it can do is really something that is quite enjoyable. But for some people, it's just a tedium and they just don't enjoy it at all. I think that covers it, Darren.
Excellent. Thanks, Andrew. That's a good point, though. For some people, I just want the quickest, fastest, simplest way to get this to happen and work and move on. For others, I want to go in depth with it and I will be there using it forever and not doing my studies. Instead, I'm caught up in the tool rather than, what it should be enabling me to do.
And just keep in mind that these tools are almost certainly going to be valuable to the person well beyond their academic studies, in work life, in recreational life. It's not just something that they need usually just for uni. It's tools they can be using in future years.
Yeah, thank you. I've found that with students as well. If you can get something that complements, things and their activities outside of their education, there's a much more, there's a greater, I think, chance of that technology being adopted and used if it's fit for purpose beyond, their education as well. Sandy, you got some thoughts on that?
I think when talking about method, probably face-to-face is probably the easiest, but like at Charles Sturt, most of our students are online, so we don't see a lot of students face-to-face. Well, I don't. Zoom and Teams works perfectly fine with training and usually set it up with the student. I get them to share their screen, so they're doing the driving and maybe I'm just assisting. And I always like, when I've given some software to change, get them to set up their accounts first, get them to have a bit of a play and don't disregard YouTube's. The people who don't like to read documents, as Andrew said, there's a lot of students who don't want to do a lot of reading. YouTube's. Now, I think probably every supplier of assistive technology has got YouTube channels out there. And I'll often give a student, here's a link to read a document. Here's a link to watch the 2-minute video of the YouTube. So YouTubes are good, particularly young people. They like YouTubes. They don't want to read. They just want to watch. And that's a way of doing it. And then if they need extra training, is it face-to-face, Zoom, Team, something like that? I also find if I'm doing it online, it's a good way of checking and they're going, oh, this doesn't work, is are they logged on properly with their software? Have they installed it properly? Have they enabled that Chrome extension? That's a good way of checking when you're looking at their screen.
Yep, that's a really good point, which kind of leads me to this one, Sandy, which, you know, is there a different approach or do you have a different approach for assistive tech for different students at different levels and years in their course?
Yeah, I think it goes back to one of those other questions. Yeah, I always say, are they undergraduate? Are they postgrad? Have they used assistive technology at different levels? You know, as I said before, if they're postgrad, it might be a new disability condition, so they didn't need assistive technology in their other courses. So you've got to treat it a little bit differently. How long ago, if they've done postgrad and they did their undergrad when they were 20 and now they're 40, 50 years old, the technology's definitely changed. And also how long they study to go too, because, yeah, because if their study might be the many, many years difference, and then, yeah, as I said, the assistive technology's changed as well. So keep that in mind, you know, what level are they in their course? They might even be in an undergraduate in year 3 and 4. Sometimes we see fourth year students who suddenly, you know, they've got through, but they've struggled. And as there's more and more reading as the years go on, now it's becoming difficult because there's so much reading. If they need a text to speech now, they didn't need it in the earlier years. So yeah, it is, you do treat them differently depending on their level of course and what level, and have they used it before. Yeah.
Thank you. Which kind of leads, and I might get you just to follow on there with our next question, Sandy, and that's the, you know, this again is a loaded question, I'll ask this of the panelists, you know, but from your experience, you've probably got something that you go to. So the question is, what's the most common assistive technology you recommend to students? What's your kind of go-to?
Yeah, look, again, it depends on the disability condition, but I would say, with the increase in autism, ADHD, mental health in probably all institutions, it's going to be that text-to-speech because it helps improve focus and concentration. Just that's very, very general, very generally based.
Yeah. Stephen?
It's definitely an immersive reader. We show it to nearly every student we see, as it's probably a benefit for them in some respect. And then sort of linking that with something like a dictation software or something to do with note taking. So sort of it's usually three, and the last one would then be something to do with transcriptions. So something to do with being able to document the stuff that they're hearing in a lecture without having to take, you know, copious amounts of notes or anything like that. So it's around those sort of three would be the most sort of advised stuff.
Yep. Francois, what's in your bag of your go-to or commonly referred bit of technology for students?
From a blindness, low vision perspective, firstly, if they are proficient and they're happy with what they've already been using, then leave them be. Don't think we need to fix something if it's not broken. But if it's somebody who has experienced vision loss, I would, and depending on their level of vision, you would recommend something like magnification software, or maybe even simply a larger screen if that would suit their needs. Then they don't even have to bother with magnification. I would definitely also recommend text-to-speech. A screen reader program, even if they can read slowly. And I saw a chat earlier on where somebody was talking about how she transitioned from initially started using Zoom Text, which is a magnification software, but then combining it with speech, because having the speech supporting the magnification, it actually helps you, it supports your learning with the speech technology. And eventually you can do this, you can use speech much quicker than the magnification software, which might slow you down depending on your level of vision. I'd also say that encourage students to join peer groups. such as Deakin has got one. I heard that UTAS also now has a peer group of students with disability where you share and get insights from other students with maybe similar needs. And I'd hope that things like the DLOs would have that information available of what kind of peer groups are running in your university.
Excellent. Thank you, Francois. And whilst a similar topic, while you've still got you there, Francois, and this is a bit of a myth, I suppose, question that myth that I'm putting in the form of question. Are students the best source for accessibility testing? Because we hear the, well, I ran it past X and they said it's fine.
Yeah, it's something I feel very passionate about, which is that nothing replaces actual end user testing. Because, yeah, automated testing can catch a few things, but getting real users to test your product, it covers all levels of proficiency. The people working in this space tend to be a super user. You know what the system does and what it's supposed to do, but the students don't. They come in here and they rely on how your system or your process prompts them to go to the next step or to open the document, whatever. So, and not everybody is a super user. So, and it's really important that our processes are built for everyone, not just for those who are super users. And the way you get that feedback, potentially external actual users, but if you can pay students to do it, that is really the best outcome.
Excellent. That's a good point. Paying the students, you know, and it is a skill, you know, and let's not forget that, you know, students actually testing things is a skill that most people don't have, and it's acquired skill that comes from experience that's there, and we should value that rather than just we ran it past somebody, you know, which was a 5-minute thing. You know, these things should be done deliberately and appropriately. So same question probably off to you, Andrew. You know, are students the best source for this accessibility testing? I know you've done your fair share of it.
Yes. I think it's valid to use students to test software, and I'm thinking mainly of software, provided they are paid for it. They shouldn't be asked to do it without remuneration. If you can get students who are using a variety of different assistive software, so you might have, you know, a student who's using speech input, one who's using a screen reader, one who's using magnification, you can then get some important feedback from people, you know, from different perspectives. As you said, Darren, it is an acquired skill. You know, you need to know what you're looking for. The other important issue, and we've touched on it in terms of people learning to use the stuff. Some people are very good at using their equipment, some are less so. And we shouldn't be just using experts to evaluate, say, a website. That can be helpful because of my background. If I look at a website, I'll often delve into the source code and I'll say, oh, they haven't got that set up properly there. I can write those comments into my report. We don't expect people who don't have that background to do that, but their experience can be equally important in that they, you know, something that I might understand because of I've done a lot of it, someone else might not. So, and they might say, look, I just don't understand what you're asking for here. And it's important to, you know, even in terms of the wording on a page, it's not just whether, you know, the links work properly or the color contrast is right. Yeah, have you phrased the questions in a form that the majority of people understand? Whenever I write software, I always try to show it to one or two people before I send it off more broadly, because, you know, something that makes sense to me as someone who writes it doesn't always make sense to others. So really important to pilot this stuff. I've wandered off a little bit, I think. But just to reiterate, yes, by all means, have students test products. Be aware that some will have different skills to others and some will have different perspectives in what they're looking for. But it can be a useful way of getting end user feedback on the product that you're developing. Thanks, Darren. Yep,
thank you. And it's a good point. I mean, you can test with one user that may have one disability and you'll get one response that fits that. But we realise our users come all very various needs, etc. So, you know, don't count everything just because it's from one point of view. And it's still not going to mean that it's 100% accessible. You know, I've always pushed that. I don't think there's any such thing as something that's 100% accessible. It's to whom. And we know our students are diverse. So we should always be testing and looking at this. Not, we looked at that a few years ago and it was fine. Well, the software has been upgraded 3 times since then. Our LMS has had a new update. We need to do some testing to make sure it, you know, it still works for a range of different technologies. Thank you for that, Andrew. Now we're going to get into some meaty bits, but I will just say thank you. I know some people have to leave because we've done this as an extended session of an hour and a half. So, you know, thank you for those that have joined us that have to run, etc. And if you do have any questions, put them into the Q&A. We'll be getting to those shortly. We've just got a couple more meaty questions that we might go into. So I'll try and get people to, or the panelists to answer as concise as they can, although these are very meaty questions, which if anybody answers this correctly, there's probably millions of dollars in this, because I don't think there's one answer, but you may all surprise me. And it's a double barrel question that we've got here. And that's the, how can we get teaching staff to engage with assistive technology in the classroom? Hand in hand with, is there something simple staff can do that can help make their teaching and learning resources more accessible? What would be that one thing you'd recommend that they do? So I might throw you first, Andrew.
I think the for the first part of the question, how can we get them to engage, is to be providing input to staff on what assistive technology is. So I guess the sort of thing we're doing right now. So people understand what the equipment is doing, what the implications are for it. I think that's a really important starting point. So if someone is using note-taking assistance software, I think it's important that the teaching staff understand why they're using it and how it works and are comfortable with it. Similarly, if someone is using, a device to read the whiteboard at a distance, again, people need to know what it does. I've given quite a few presentations and turn the screen reader on. And so often afterwards, one of my colleagues will say to me, they could just see light bulbs switching on around the room when people understood what the screen reader is doing and what is involved with using it to read documents and to read websites. And sometimes I've demonstrated to people who have actually written stuff that isn't really good, and they see me struggling to find a button and so forth, and they think, oh dear, that's because I didn't do it properly. So I think that's very helpful for people to understand it, not to shame people, but just so that they understand how to do it. But that brings me to one of my hobby horses. So in terms of making material more accessible, the word structure comes to mind. I am a huge advocate of material being structured correctly. And if documents, whether it's a web page or a Word document or a PDF document or a PowerPoint, if it is structured correctly, And we haven't got time to go into huge detail about what that means now, but you'll get some resources at the end. That makes reading that document with products such as screen readers, literacy assistance software, very easy. If it is not structured well, so if there are no formal headings and tables are used for layout and images don't have alternative descriptions, and so forth, then lots of people will spend a lot of effort and not get much out of it. So again, that comes to providing staff with input on how to structure documents correctly, and whether they're academics or whether they're people who are producing material, you know, for the academic. And the really important thing to get across to people when we're badgering them and telling them that they have to structure stuff correctly is that once they know how to do it, it will save them a huge amount of time from now on. So while someone may argue, I don't have time to learn how to do all that, they're actually, it happened to someone in my family actually when they were going through uni, and I was asked to look at their essays, and I kept grumbling that they're not structured properly, and they kept saying, I haven't got time. And that person is now a high school teacher and is absolutely real keen on students structuring stuff properly because it saves a whole lot of time.
I couldn't probably agree more
with that. It is so important because what's happened in the past is that people could be spending hours and hours on remediating a document to make it accessible, whereas if it's done well in the first place, and as I say, it is quicker to do it like that than it is to be bolding and underlining and so forth as you go through. It just makes such a huge difference. And a lot of the assistive technology, particularly screen readers, but others as well, really rely on stuff being done well, whether it's a Word document or a web page.
Yep, I can see you nodding away there, Steve.
My rant now. You
can... That's all right. Thank you, Andrew. I see you nodding away there. We're talking about structure. We're talking about headings. So again, I'll throw that same question to you there. How can we get teaching staff to engage with assistive tech in the classroom? And is there something simple that they can do to improve the accessibility of their own resources?
I'm gonna be a bit chaotic here and say that I disagree with Andrew on not shaming them. Shame is a very powerful tool. And it functions. It might not function the one-on-one and when you get an academic in front of you and you're talking about their process and all this sort of stuff, but on a functional institutional level, you get the most bang for your buck. So if you say to somebody, we're not meeting, we've got a disability action plan at La Trobe, we've got a new one in the works that's even more sort of stringent, that's been signed off by the university, it's been signed off by the VC, and then there's also the federal legislation that and informs it. When you show them this stuff and you say, we're not meeting this stuff, they tend to get really, they tend to sit up really stiff in their chair. And you don't get that when you're trying to buy them into the process where it's like, we need this nice thing for the student, because it's always seen as the add-on, which is the misnomer. So I think, how can we get teaching staff to engage? Shame is my most used tool. I don't want to use it. It gets used a lot. It seems to get the most out of it. Is there something simple? Garbage in, garbage out, as Andrew said. If you don't put anything good into something, you're not going to get anything good out of it. You've got to walk back the process. And going to a question that's in the Q&A about, types of resource types, ideally it would be, everything would be HTML, it would be nice and all this sort of stuff. But what we've found through, practical experience is if you can walk them back to something like a docx and then they export out of that into, you can export out of Word into PowerPoint or any of these other pieces of software, you're generally going to get a good idea of what the accessible document will look like, but it also provides an alternative format for that document, which is another thing that you should be providing anyway. So if you've got something that is, if you're only providing something in one form, you're not really meeting a requirement to provide it in a form that someone else might need. So you want to stick with two, and that Word doc or that standard will get you to those secondary sort of resources, which is par for the course. So you want to, you know, you want to kind of regress your process to find where the garbage is getting created and why it's getting created, and then address that. That can go for any type of resource that you're dealing with. But yeah, shame.
Shame. Okay. Different perspectives. That's good. Good. Thank you for that. Francois, similar question for you, and being a staff member now as well. So how do you get yourself to engage with accessible tech in the classroom? No. How do you get other staff to engage with that? And, you know, what's that one simple thing that you'd love staff to be doing to make their resources more accessible?
Yeah, basically it depends on the setting. I'd say if you're online, online classroom setting, use, if you're posting videos, use alternative, include alternative links to videos with audio description and captioning, not just the standard one without it. If you also intend voting, again, consider accessible alternatives like Zoom, where you can do polling, and where students can also post to the chat more easily than some other platforms. But now, if you're in the classroom itself, you might post. You could even consider playing the audio described and captioned video rather than the one that doesn't have it. There's another example of, strictly speaking, mainstream tech, which in my view can function as assistive technology, which is if there is a microphone and speakers in the class, then use it, no matter how loud you think your voice is, because then, I mean, people always say, can you hear me at the bottom of the back of the class? And people would probably just say yes, or you're forcing them to out themselves if they don't want to. And nobody would have to publicly disclose this ability if they don't want to. Just in terms of slides, making sure that they're accessible, using Microsoft's resources. And if you don't know how to do it, then just Google it, basically. And the bottom line of all this is that we don't need to have all the answers. All you need is to know who to ask. And just lastly, I could say that every one of us can have a role in advocating for a process that really ensures that when all this information gets sent to our unit staff on what they need to know and need to do, include this information about accessibility, who they can go to if they don't know how to make their content accessible.
That's a really good point. And again, I think, you know, all teaching staff are going to come to this different things, but, you know, there is a point of standardization, I think, that comes there. There's a point of getting things up to, you know, at least a bare minimum. I think that's there. And structure is certainly, it's one of my go-to, you know, it's the headings. Put headings in is probably the first thing and simplest thing you can do. And if you don't know how to do that, we can show you all. We've got videos that Andrew's produced that we've linked to later in this that we'll get to. Now, we are slightly over time in terms of where we want to do the question. So I'm just going to skip the next one because this is a topic, you know, what's the biggest change you've noticed in development over the years, because we could go on for an hour about everything that's changed and is still changing. So I'll quickly skip to one of our last questions, then we'll get to some questions from those that have joined us today. And that is, I'll throw this out to you first, Steve. Where do you see the future of assistive technology and what are the challenges ahead?
I mean, you'd be remiss if you didn't mention AI at the moment. It's just barged its way in the last month or so, and that's probably 60% of the questions I get from academics at the moment is how is this going to integrate with what we're already doing. I think what it will do is it will approach what you said before, Darren, the idea of standardization. getting to something that's, and it's almost a regression for me. It's going back to something that was actually working, because what we've done isn't really working in that space. So I think the future of assistive tech is actually regression back to a medium that works moving forward. My concern is that after that explosion of the 3 years of sort of hot online primarily, and then slightly back to hybrid, there's been a regression back to bad practice with PDFs and this sort of stuff. It'll be interesting to watch where it goes, but I definitely feel like the future is AI driven. I don't want to say it's dominated by it, because it's not. I think people are putting a lot of expectations at its feet, and it's not going to meet those expectations. Not meant to, but you're going to see a lot of content being written by it, a lot of sort of moderation of a moderation of content written by it and moderated by it. You're going to see moderation of communication channels. So if a student asks a question, they're going to get an answer from it rather than someone in the course. So it's going to remove a lot of the day-to-day stuff, which is going to change the way that students engage with it, I think.
Yeah, and I think most of the technology, or a lot of the technology we're using today, is ways that we used to do things. We used to read to tape. We used to have people read the text to tape. We've now got synthetic speech. So it's still doing the same process. It's converting to a different format for a different sense, but we're just using technology to do it. AI will help, I think, speed some of that up. Andrew, I'm going to give you 2 minutes and then I'm going to cut you off to answer the same question, because I'm sure you can tell us all about the future as well. But where do you see the future of assistive tech, and what are those challenges?
Just to go back very slightly initially, one of the really important and very helpful developments over the past little while has been the integration of a lot of the stuff we've talked about into computers and phones. So, screen readers that used to cost lots of money, and still can if you want to, but can built into phones and computers. And I see the potential for that developing further. As Steve mentioned, I think AI has some potential with all the hand-wringing about ChatGPT, and everyone's going to plagiarize and stuff. I read an interesting thing where for people who require augmentative communication, then something like that could be a really nice tool for helping their communication. So I think there's potential there. One of my real concerns is some of the dreadful coding that's being put onto web-based products. It is some of us call it spaghetti code, and I think that's, if we stray away from good coding, the proper word's just gone out of my head, then we run the risk of making lots of material inaccessible. So I think we've got to keep pushing that people, semantic was the word I was looking for. If we need semantic code, and there are guidelines and stuff for that, and a lot of people aren't following them, and I see that as a potential problem.
Thank you, Andrew. And I think, we're definitely moving into that space where, again, I go back to standardization, and some of these things, will certainly be key. And that fits in with, ICT procurement that Steve had mentioned earlier as well. Making sure we get products that are built to produce standards and things to start with that out of the box are much better. And then we educate our users on making sure that the outputs of those are much more friendly than we're helping everybody in that space. I'll just quickly skip through to one last part and then we'll go to questions. So the webinar, as mentioned, is being recorded. The slides and everything will be made available. If we don't get a chance to get through everybody's questions today, we'll answer those and put those up onto the website along with the recording. And you will have access to the slides and links to some of the text that we've spoken about today. So there is some further further information and resources there. I'll just quickly plug one of them, and that's the ADCET Assist, which is sessions that people can book in one-on-one, and we'll put the link to that in chat for people to have a session, you know, with myself and just to discuss some of the stuff that we spoke to today, but also the fact that you know, there's no one size fits all. You know, every student's unique, everything's there, so we can look at some of those options, and if I'm not aware of it, then I can throw it out to the community practice as well, and I can check with members there, because there's a wealth of information and experience across. So I'll just say thank you quickly to the panelists for helping us out today, and to Francois again for jumping in at the last minute and putting your, you know, expertise into this discussion as well, and experience. It's very much appreciated. And I'll throw back to you, Gabby. Thank you, everybody.
Well, thank you, panel. That's fabulous. So we do have some questions here in the Q&A, and I noticed some people have been putting in the chat, so please transfer them over to the Q&A. One of the first questions is about teaching biostatistics. So example maths formulas, and they're asking about what the best way to insert maths formulas into documents so that they are accessible for screen readers. And I think that goes to the bigger question of those sorts of STEM related disciplines where you're using maths formulas and diagrams and graphs and all those sorts of things. So
I'm happy to take that one if you want. I've just been doing a lot of work on equations over the last few weeks, actually, and we don't have time to give you a full answer, but these days, if you are using Office 365 and you write an equation into the equation editor in Word, both the JAWS and NVDA screen readers can read that as a math equation, and that equation can also be exported as a MathML equation. I've also been doing some playing with MathJax. That's a website, and again, even if you put a latex equation into the web page, that will read really nicely with a screen reader. So there are some options becoming available.
It's a tough question, Gabby. Because it depends. Input can come in many ways and forms. Yeah. But that's a really short answer to. But there's lots of resources around.
There's a lot more to it than that.
But. Yeah, that's a good start, though. I think that's really helpful for people. The next question is about how have you found remote learning where NBN is not as reliable for various technologies? What strategies would you recommend for students who are living in regional or remote areas, or their NBN isn't working in the metro area?
Andy, you're probably best for that one.
Yeah, all the time. Look, you know, like if the NBN's not working, if they're learning online, how are they accessing their material? And look, I've hit times when I'm with a student and it cuts out, and so I usually ring the student. And yeah, it's a little bit more difficult with the training and all that. But maybe also think about assistive technology. They've got a really unreliable internet connection. Don't give them software that relies that needs internet access to work. Keep away from it. Look at some other resources because it's not going to work properly for them. It's just going to be frustrating while they're learning.
Yeah, avoid some of those. I'll go more for the standalone resources. Just quickly, I remember a student many years ago that had and I've mentioned this a couple of times, when dad doesn't need the internet and it's a Friday afternoon, I've got this window between 1 and 3 when the satellite aligns with the farmhouse and I can get good signal and download things. And so the advice that ended up going back to course coordinator was stop making, you know, 300 meg videos. You know, or the student could use an audio file that's only 5 meg because they can download that and things like that. Or send the script. You don't need to send the video. It doesn't need to be there. There's, you know, other formats that can be used to work within the confines of what was there.
So there was a question about training, and I think we've already talked about that. But the next question is, thinking about providing learning resources, what resource types or combination of types, example, docx, PDF, HTML, would the panel be advising to provide students for the widest use for the range of assistive technologies?
sure we can all jump
any,
in.
Any of them, provided they're done well, that'd be my comment. A lot of screen reader users get very grumpy about PDFs, largely because about 90% of PDFs are really badly done. But if they're done properly, then they work quite well with screen readers and other technologies. But any of them, provided they are done well.
I think Steve touched on that. If you could do it as HTML, you know, first, which most people won't be able to necessarily do, then that at least meets some standard, you would hope. But then failing that, you know, my recommendation is probably go to Word document. It's probably what most academics are using. They've probably got access to the Office suite. Do a well-structured, again, what Andrew was saying, a well-structured Word document, and 99% of students would be able to use that. And
it depends on the environment too. If it's an online course, then I'd be trying to stick to HTML. If you have a downloadable resource, then that could be a Word or a PDF, but it's really irritating doing an online course and you're just joining PDFs together with conjunctions.
an offshoot of that is another question about what's the best PDF converter, because Adobe Pro is expensive. So is there a free option out there that people can use?
I heard that question come through. Was that converting to PDF or from PDF?
Oh, just said PDF converter.
Right. So converting to PDF, and then save as PDF, again, provided the document's properly structured, you will get a very good PDF. So just do it straight from the Word document, save as, and select PDF, and go into options and make sure that tags for accessibility is checked and headings are checked. That'll work well. Going the other way, I've got a couple of pretty ordinary PDFs recently, and just open them in the Word document. Don't convert from Acrobat, just open in the Word document, and that works in terms of making the thing at least readable. That's actually worked quite well, including some stuff where some OCR, which is optical character recognition, was required. So yeah, just open it in Word.
Great. And I think that we've just got time for this last question. Someone said, I teach computer programming and it's maths heavy electronic engineering courses. I'd be interested to learn about tools in this space. For example, tools and techniques to make maths formulas, circuit diagrams, code accessible for screen readers and other text-to-speech tools. I know we've touched on it briefly, and I know you said there's heaps of things people can do, but where should they look first for this kind of stuff?
I mean, the code should be okay. Screen readers, et cetera, will read the code quite happily. It's your diagrams where you're going to run into more problems, certainly for screen reader users. There are some things that just can't be done well on the internet for screen reader users, and complex diagrams is certainly one of them. So you're looking at producing raised line diagrams. And again, Darren will hit me if I go into more detail about that, but there's some quite nice resources for doing that. But as Sandy's mentioned earlier, it is requires some time and expertise to get that right. But for in terms of the equations and the coding, that should work pretty well just with a text editor.
Can I just add something about diagrams there onto what Andrew said? One thing we've found, I just swear tactile diagrams are great, but another strategy we had, this is for biology, and we actually asked the lecturer, instead of, you can add alternative text, so all diagrams should have alternative text. It doesn't have to be hugely descriptive, but if it's, for this case, it was biology, and we got the lecturer to, as if they were talking to the student, put that in as alt text, because they're very complex biological pitch, and that was good for the student.
And the other option, by the way, is 3D printers. Huge resource, huge potential.
Francois?
It is a bit geeky, but I guess the person asked the question. So I could refer them to the roundtable on print disability. Yep. They have a lot of resources, and every year they present at a national conference, and there's forever new technologies coming on mathematics, making it more accessible, things like sonification. So it's definitely, if you're interested in that, go look at the resources on the Roundtable website.
Thanks very much, Francois. Actually, the Roundtable for 2023, their conference is coming up soon, and we'll add that to the chat as well. So that's all we've got time for today. Just a couple more things before we finish today. Thank you to our wonderful panel, and thank you, Darren, for pulling all of this this group together, this great expertise there. Before we finish today, our next seminar is on, or webinar rather, is on Monday the 2nd of March, and it's about disability discrimination in the tertiary sector with Elizabeth Dixon, who's the senior law lecturer at QUT. And then on the 21st of March, we've just opened registrations for Brandon Taylor from TAFE talking about mental ill health. Now, as I said, don't forget to remember that Darren's brain is available at any time through our ADCET Assist service, and there's information on the website about that, and further details about times and registration for all our webinars are coming up soon. So make sure you mark your calendar.
I may quickly, Gabby, sorry, if I can just add one thing that I did forget to say. We are currently compiling from the Assistive Tech community of practice a list of all the software and apps and that are currently in use at various institutions around Australia. And I think we've got about 30 plus institutions represented there. So we'll have a list of what's currently in play, not everything that's out there, but what's currently being used in the environment. We'll try and keep that up to date. So stay tuned for that. We'll have that up in the next couple of weeks.
So again, thank you. The web recording will be out soon with the transcripts and all this information and the links that we've talked about today. So thank you very much for coming today.
Thank you. Thank you, panel. And thank you, Donna, for the captioning today. Much appreciated.
No trouble.